Thanks. All right. So we were hustling and stressing because we have a Diablo font and it was not working. So this is why we switched laptop last minute, and like we really want the thing to be themed properly, and so for you to enjoy this thing. So this is quite an adventure that we're gonna talk about today. Disclaimer, there's a lot of nerdiness in there. There's a lot of tongue-in-cheek references to Dungeons and Dragons. Those who don't know, I'm sorry. Those who do will enjoy it. We were inspired by Stranger Things last year, obviously, which made it very popular, bring it to the forefront. But also the movie Dungeons and Dragons, Honor Among Thieves, that was out in March when we were doing the CFP, obviously. And I am a big Dungeons and Dragons player. But so we thought we could pull it off. Thank you. We thought we could pull it off because it was in the mainstream, right? It is trendy, but we're gonna end the pop culture reference here. It's gonna be like the more OG Dungeons and Dragons stuff. So I'm Oliver, I'm a cybersecurity research director at GoSecure, and?
And I'm Andrea Bergeron. I have a PhD in criminology, and I also work as a cybersecurity researcher at GoSecure, so I'm interested in the criminal behavior and decision makings and everything.
Thank you. So today's quest, all right? So our agenda, if you want, we're gonna talk about RDP interception. We're gonna, like, you need to understand what's possible and how it can be done and what tools we used, but this is not the core focus of this presentation. We were then gonna dive into attacker classes, so like barbarians and thieves and stuff like that. We summarize over 190 million events. An event is basically a log line, so a JSON log. We're gonna summarize what we collected. Then we're gonna talk about the tools of the hacker, what they use, their weapons, their swords and their axes and shit. And we're gonna then show some really cool, interesting, memorizable sessions. So here are the characters we're gonna cover today. So pretty dark themed and stuff like that. Custom art made by a friend from Montreal. And let's go. So why RDP? Why, Olivier, are you so insane about RDP, not giving up after 4 years, still at it? It's because it's targeted by humans. I've ran like SSH and Telnet honeypots for years, and these are attacked by scripts and you know, malware, automated stuff. There's not like the richness, the human behind the keyboard aspect. When we started doing RDP research, I expected automated malware, I expected bots, but this is not what happened. What happened was a lot of human interactions. And so this is why it's very interesting and really ripe for research, ripe for intelligence collection. But Olivier, you keep talking about RDP. What is RDP? Okay. I'm like way too into this, sorry. So this is the, on the left-hand side, this is the MSTSC client. So basically RDP is, you know, remote desktop protocol. So it is a client that allows you to connect to a remote computer and then interact with it graphically. So you have the display, you have the keyboard, you have the mouse, you have sound, and the clipboard and files can be shared via RDP. So we are all on the same page, we understand this is what this is about. Now, the attack that are done, what allows us to study RDP at this level is because of a tool called PyRDP. I have stickers in my bag, if you want, of the logo, made by the same guy who made the art for this talk. It is an interception engine, so it can intercept everything, record everything, and you can tamper with the RDP. And you can watch after the fact, after everything is collected, you can look at the capture that were done. So everything we present today was powered by or enabled by PyRDP. Now,
let's take our crystal ball and take a look at what it looks like, what the tool looks like. Sorry. So here, this is our tool, so it's the PyRDP player. So this is what we see when we analyze the sessions. So when it will start in a second, you'll see the screen of the attacker and everything that's going on it. And then you'll see the mouse movement on the with the little yellow dot. And then here you'll see everything that goes through the clipboard and the keyboard, so everything that it types or copy paste. And at the beginning of the session, like here, you see the host and the domain they use to connect and the credential they use also. So it starts. So right here we see in the clipboard, the first thing we steal is our IP address. It's the last thing it copy paste basically. Here we see the attacker type, and we see everything, like, and even here it will change the creds to enter the session. And even if we don't see on the screen, we see it on the clipboard capture. What's interesting here is that the attacker pastes his C drive directly on our system, so we can basically steal everything. And here he proceeds with his activity, which is using XMRID. So it's basically a surveillance camera for Windows system.
So the way we deployed this in the cloud, and we exposed only the PyRDP system. You can see in this diagram that we carefully firewalled with OG castles our system. But so the Windows system, it was not exposed directly. You had to go through the RDP interception engine in order to reach it. This is what we want to convey here. That is important. And if you want to learn more about PyRDP, since this talk is not about PyRDP, there's a ton of references out there, ton of blog posts, ton of stuff. And the guy who first wrote PyRDP as an intern working with me is even here, Emilio. Shout out to Emilio Gonzalez. And so you can see his talks, his blog posts, and his presentations about it. But now we collected data with it, and let's talk about that. So welcome to the Dungeon Adventurers. Sorry about that. So what we have is we collected events for over 3 years, 190 million events, as I said earlier. This is like 21 million net NTLM v2 hashes because we support NLA network level authentication. We have like 2,500 successful logins, okay? I'm gonna give you an insight. Our password is admin. So 2,000 people figured that out. And then we collected via that 478 files and more than 2,300 valid captures that we could replay, see the keyboard, the clipboard, mouse movement, all of that stuff.
Some of those sessions are related, right? The attacker might connect to our system more than once, for example. And there's a couple of evidence that we can observe to group them. So the first one would be like if they change the password and then come back on our system with this password, so we know it's the same person, or when there's a continuity of activities throughout the different session. So those are all evidence that that we use to group them. And when we group the final data set that we have 95 different attackers or group of attackers. From the 2,300 session, there's 455 session with some content so that they actually connect to the server and open the system. But they are not all interesting because sometimes they just connect and disconnect. So over that, there's 339 session of interest that we analyzed, and this is what we are presenting today. If we take a look at the indicator of the MITRE attack framework, this is what we get. So there's a lot of resource hijacking, system network configuration discovery, active scanning, including scanning IP blocks and word list scanning. So basically what you see the most is reconnaissance and discovery. So let's see what are the different profile of behavior that we see on our sessions. So this is our party. There's five different profile, and we will see we sealed them one by one. So maybe you didn't notice it already, but this one is the ranger, okay? And he's stealthy. You'll understand why. So the ranger will explore all the folder of the computer and or check the network and host performance characteristics. They run reconnaissance through program or script, and or they can also run this reconnaissance just by clicking their way through, like opening the task manager, looking at the CPU performance, and then Googling our IP address. And they do not perform any other meaningful action on our session, so they just run reconnaissance. So we hypothesize that they might be evaluating the system for others to use or to use later. I'll show you a ranger in action. So here, yeah, it started. So here it will paste two binaries on the desktop to run. So those are read script that are ready to just grab the information of the system. So it runs the first one and then runs the second one. It copies the information of the computer, and we can and we steal that on through the clipboard. And then before leaving, it will erase all his traces and leave. Okay? So this is a typical ranger in action. The second character is the thief. The thieves will monetize their the RDP access in many different ways. So they will the tool they use will be like proxyware, monetizing browsers that participate in the pay-to-serve schemes. After that, there's a crypto miner, Android emulator to do fraud, so all kind of different things to monetize the access. And I'll show you two examples. So the first one here, the person is using Traf Monetizer, which is a residential proxy enabler. We'll connect to his account, and then you can see. So they use it to pass third-party traffic through our system and then get paid for doing so. So you see the amount of money that he is doing with our session, which is not a lot, by the way. The second example of a thief in action will be this one that used a crypto miner called XMRig. So he launched the crypto miner, connect to his wallet with his creds and everything. He chose Bitcoin Gold to mine. And at the bottom, you see the local hash rate and the effective hash rate that goes on during that. He can conduct any other activity at the same time, and it will. So the third character is the barbarian. The barbarian, you'll understand by the name of the character, that they use a large array of tools to brute force their way into more computers. They compromise other systems by working with IP addresses, username, list of passwords, and here is the barbarian in action. So here the person is using mass scan. GUI, more particularly, so there's an interface easier to use. Here they enter the RDP, the RDP port 3389, and choose the country that they want to target. In this case, Vietnam. Launch the attack, and it's as easy as. The fourth character is the wizard. The wizard is my favorite one because they are the most skillful one. They use the RDP access as a portal to connect to other computers, so they secure their identity via a jump over compromised host. So they are the one who show the highest level of skills, and I'll show you in this session right now. So they are on our RDP session, and then they connect to another session through our system. So you see that in our session, the wizard is fileless. They do not require to install any code or script within the target system. Instead, the attacker uses tools that are already present in the environment, and in this case, it's RDP. So you see that there's a session opened here, and on which NL brute is open. So they launch an attack using a brute force tool, and here we see that they use a ghost user. We will come back to this. So it's connected to a tool they use to enter other RDP session. So and we will talk about it in a second. So he is monitoring his NL brute activities on two other PyRDP sessions through two other PyRDP sessions. So this makes it far more difficult to detect, especially if the organization are leveraging traditional security tools that will search for known malware script or file. They can stay there forever before being flagged, basically, and they leave no artifacts behind. And the last character, I said that the wizard was my favorite one, but this one is my favorite one. So the bard. The bard in Dungeon and Dragon, I don't want to start a debate here, but in Dungeon and Dragon, it's sometimes considered as the small contributor or the annoying team player. So here, in this case, the bard has no apparent hacking skills. Okay. So they will use our system to make basic Google search, to watch porn, and to download movies, etc. So we think that they might have bought their access through someone else that compromised the computer for them. And just for the laugh, I need to show you a bard in action. So here we see basic Google search about the strongest virus ever. And he will, look for information about that, read a bit on that. I just translate what is going on this page. Basically, just information about the strongest virus. Here, another virus script. He looks around, but it doesn't last very long. He abandoned right away and go watch porn. So there's a couple of research about porn, so porn.com, sex.com, sex.org. He's trying really hard, Iranian porn. And then we can see the beginner level of porn consuming as he is looking for porn on YouTube. He even types Pornhub, so he knows about it, but it's hard. Why porn? So there's some country with internet censorship, and this censorship include ban on pornography. So they might and also they often block for VPNs and other tools. So they might use our RDP access just to go around those ban. So if we look at the number of RDP sessions associated with each profile, this is what we get. So you see a lot of barbarian, a lot of rangers, and after that, thieves, bard, wizard. And the profile are not mutually exclusive. They might intertwine. This is what we get when we observe this mix. So a ranger might also do barbarian actions. What about the weaponry, Olivier?
Yes. So we did build some kind of a character sheets for the weapons, because I'm a geek and a Dungeon and Dragon fans. So here we go. The XDidzik RDP patch is a ranger tool. So it is what we saw earlier that created the ghost user account. So it's basically a turnkey GUI tool that creates an admin account and allow you to patch RDP. Patch RDP in a specific way, in a sense that it will allow desktop versions of the operating system to have concurrent sessions, which is not allowed usually. You need a specific license or you need a server type system. But this will enable that, meaning that the computer can be used while it's used legitimately. And the patch is actually very well done. It's a different binary that is embedded in the XDidzik tool, and it survives OS updates and stuff like that. It's a really clever tool. So we see this as a persistent mechanism, has a high detection ratio on VT because it's super packed. But the XDidzik group was taken down, but the tools still exist and are still available. Next up, we're going to talk about NL Brute. So Andréane mentioned it earlier. NL Brute is the RDP brute forcing tool. It is a super effective one. If we have pen testers or red teamers here, this stuff is better than, you know, Hydra or Nmap. But I wouldn't run it on a system besides a VM. Again, super packed. The versions that you can download online are like cracked and or probably backdoored. It has a relatively high VT detection ratio. However, the some of the samples that I've seen are undetected by CrowdStrike, ESET, F-Secure, Kaspersky, for instance. So detection ratio is still high, it's like 15 to 62. But the 15 are like all AI stuff that probably has a lot of false positive. The guy who wrote it got arrested and extradited to the US early February. So we will probably not see updates for a short while. So the next up is Mass Scan GUI, a tool used by Barbarians. It is like a wrapper around Robert Graham's Mass Scan, very effective internet scanner. But it dumbs it down so that anyone can use it. And you can choose a country, so it has like pre-filled configuration in it if you want to target a specific country. What's something that I didn't realize, because we have a lot of instinct about attackers, right? Because we do that, we research, you know, for threats and we read a lot of blogs. But one thing that surprised me is the pivoting capabilities of the Barbarians. So when they compromise a specific system, they go after nearby networks or the whole internet. But for instance, our stuff was in AWS. And so we feel that when they realize it's in the AWS, they're happy because they're like, oh, maybe some organization whitelisted AWS ranges. And so they scan the whole internet like super triggered. So we think that this is some of the stuff that they do, and it allows them to reach stuff that wasn't reachable before or via other compromised infrastructure. So a tool like Masscan GUI kind of is important for them to penetrate into deeper networks and more networks. The next one is a weird one. Silver Bullet. It's a Burp-like web application security tool, if you want. But the comparison with Burp fell short really quickly because it's proxy first. So in Burp, you use one proxy, and then you do your tests and stuff like that. But this is like, give me 100 of proxies. So clearly, this is about credential stuffing, popular services like PayPal, Gmail, and Netflix or whatever. It comes with pre-made configuration kits, a whole scripting language. It is super talked about on Telegram. There are channels dedicated to share configurations. So it's a very big tool for people who compromises online accounts. Clearly, very little legitimate use, but it's distributed on GitHub, and they talk about it openly on GitHub, and this is from the GitHub page, and they say like this is for scraping, parsing data, automated pen testing, uses Selenium or whatever. But look at this, like if we check the tabs that are in there, it's like top level tab proxies, where you provide hundreds of proxies that you want to use. Second tab, word lists. I mean, what pen test tool would expose word list as a first class component in your tool, right? And then you have like captchas, bypass, you have OCR, so character recognition, you have Cloudflare bypass built into the configurations. So clearly, again, little legitimate use or you know, it's shady, really shady. Now on their website, they even like drop the language about automated pen test. They basically say like it's illegal, but they talk about credential stuffing. It's like, oh yeah, we're a web pen testing tool. No, we're a credential stuffing tool, right? This is making it very clear. But what I like the most about disclaimers like this is, of course, you said for research only, this is gonna stop cybercrime. Fuck them. Oh, sorry about that. So moving on to the next thing, we have the Windows Defender remove script. So a lot of Defender bypass technology was used, and it's interesting to describe, especially this one, because it has a zero virus total detection rate. But so it's a wrapper around install Wim tweaks, which is considered a legitimate package. It allows you to change the Microsoft's OS can be customized by auto unattend stuff, right? And it allows you to alter the OS packages like you would do for a POS or for an ATM, for instance, if you are stupid enough to use Windows for an ATM. But it unhides the OS packages that are protected, allows you to remove Defender the package, and then it will repack the Windows packages so Windows still works afterwards. But so this is pretty crazy because it is basically legitimate software. However, I want to say it doesn't work on Windows 11 even with tamper protection removed. So we've seen this work on Windows Server 2016. Haven't tested more than that because I was, you know, busy creating nice sheets, cards for the for the attack tools. But so it could, like, you know, become obsolete with time, but it is effective today. Another one that I wanted to talk about is dControl or Defender Control. And this one is shared online as a freeware from a super shady site. It is super packed. Has a high VT ratio, and I think they're not gonna update it. But this tool is used by the luckiest Russian ransomware group. Like, we know it's linked through them, so we know that it is used by ransomware groups out there. So it disables Defender and unload the driver, so it's effective. Doesn't require reboot, whereas the other tool does require reboot. But it's been super well documented by the DFIR report. So if you guys want to detect this, I think they even provide Sigma rules and stuff like that. So I would advise you check that. And last but not least is Gamadyne Mailer. So this is a turnkey, noob-friendly phishing tool. So it can be used for spear phishing, but also spam. So it does the whole spectrum of email flaws, have a templating engine, and all that stuff. It is basically making it possible for people to send, you know, good emails and whatnot. But we think that the IP reputation of compromised system is probably what attracts people to deploy tools like this in honeypots, so that they are able to send their spam. It is not detected by, like, CrowdStrike, ESET, F-Secure, Kaspersky, Microsoft. So it has a low detection ratio, and we know it's not. But then again, like, all of the samples I shared in the IOC I've provided, I uploaded all of them on VT, so they will probably, the detection ratio will probably increase, hopefully. So we're gonna be good. We're gonna detect this very soon. There is a lot more tooling, and our aim is to document them via our blog. And as you know, some of them don't need documentation, but some of them do. And share, you know, hashes and Sigma rules for detection.
So if we take this list that we just saw and all the tools that we present, and we classify them by objective, this is what we get. So a lot of scanning and attack. Then there's enabler tool that they use all the time, monetization, download, communication. By communication, I refer more precisely to Telegram. So they use Telegram to communicate, but also to transfer files. We see that a lot. So let's go back to our crystal ball. We wanted to show you in some interesting observation that we saw during our research. So first, the attacker might work in team. Okay, here we see the person downloading NL Brute, while on the clipboard we see appear. I'll translate it right now. Why did you delete all application with a broken heart? So, downloading the tools again, they were there on a session, a previous session, but then he has to download again and then communicate with someone else to show his disappointment or her disappointment. After that, there's some attacker who do not speak English, and that might be funny sometimes. So here, the person is playing around with some credit card on Google Ad, and then a pending approval message appears. And the person has no clue what's going on, so copies it, goes into Google Translate, and then even go choose the exact language the person speaks. So really, you cannot beat this level of attribution. So Arabic here. And we have a couple of sessions with with people who do not speak English, who look like they do not speak English, or at least their basic language, their principal language is not English. And when we analyze those sessions, so it's 45 sessions in which we are sure of the attribution of the language, which is not all the data set, but this is what we get. So Arabic first, and then Farsi or Persian, Cyrillic, Vietnamese, and Chinese. And the last video we wanted to show you is how great our tool is to collect intelligence. So here, the person is connecting to their Telegram account. So they will enter their cell phone number, their phone number. Obviously, they could use burning phone, right? But here we could, when we look at the IP address, it corresponds to Algeria. And then like their password, of course, that we can steal to the clipboard. And then once they connect to their Telegram, we can see all the chat room in which there's some illegal stuff going on. So to start an investigation, it's a lot of information, of useful information. What about the end game?
Yes. We're now at the near the end of the presentation, so it's time for experience points, of course, and loot, right? But so I'm still going to spend some time trying to really convey why the level of enthusiasm I want you guys to leave with around like RDP, research, and interception. So this is how we deployed our environments. We made the Windows machines, like the box in the middle. We made it. We made sure to stream the logs to a message queue as quick as we can in order for it to be destroyable. So we really like don't like to give free infrastructure to bad guys. So when we have like anything that is, you know, misused, we will destroy the infrastructure because it's faster to destroy than to investigate. But this means that we, in order not to lose evidence, we needed to have something streaming to our stuff, right? So all open source stuff, but like streaming logs to RabbitMQ, rsyncing binary artifacts to object storage, then we are slurping these for inside an Elastic, where we query it via Jupyter, RStudio as well, so some R language code for like Latin class analysis and stuff like that, and then good old Excel because it's just fast, you know. But after a million records or events, Excel just blows up. So you need the Python cool kids tools. Everything was deployed using Docker Compose, and then the infrastructure was terraformed, and we were recreating, like destroying the honeypots and recreating them so that we get fresh bad guys. Using GitLab CI/CD automation. Now, what we talked about today is the Rangers, right, on the left. They are the largest group and clearly the ones that we want to go after next, right? We're going to increase the deception that we do and make sure that we understand what they are after, because they're the big group and they open the path to others. Then there's the bard of questionable technical skills and appetite, as Andréane showed you earlier. We saw the thieves. Thieves, for me, represent what cybercrime is about. And this is a takeaway, I think, important for our industry. They are about monetizing everything. They are not after your organization necessarily. Like most of cybercrime is like that, right? Of course there are spies and state actors and stuff like that, but there's a ton of cybercrime out there that is just opportunistic. The wizards are the scariest group, in my opinion and Andréane's opinion, because they are doing the living off the land stuff. They like leave no artifacts, really are really stealthy. And the barbarians, last but not least, they just brute force their way around, as I was saying earlier, like compromising new infrastructure, and it is successful, unfortunately. Now, researchers, like RDP is ripe for attacker study. It attracts humans, not scripts, so it's super cool to do. For Blue Team, like we have a repository called Malware IOC on our GitHub. The link is at the end of the slide deck. It's in the slide deck that is shared on the DEF CON servers already. You can consume the IOCs, but we also want you to try to roll out your own traps. You can do it externally. You can do it internally. Internally, this is like a low false positive rate alarm system, but you must make sure that you have the proper alerting in place. What's cool about doing that is the video captures talk so well to management. This is not a sequence of logs that, you know, people don't understand. This is like, he did this, he was after that, like directly show it in your face, the attacker, right? So this is why it's powerful. For law enforcement, we want you to go after the ransomware groups. This needs to end, right? We are really in ransomware groups are like the exploit kits of the 2010, something like that. Like, we need to fix that problem. And the reason why RDP interception is relevant in that context, it's because when they use compromised infrastructure, a lot of RDP compromised infrastructure, when you look at the metadata, like law enforcement would do in lawful contexts, you will have like SMTP out to Office 365, SMTP out to Google. But what does that tell you? You have no victim information, you have nothing, right? If you lawfully intercept the RDP, you see them write the emails that they send. You can go after the victims. So it's a very effective way to build a case quickly in my mind. So like, I'm giving this open source for free so that you can change the world and fix this shit. I'm really passionate about that, by the way. Sorry. Thank you. So yeah, I guess this leads well into the, if the attacker fear getting caught, you know, they will slow down. And this is what this is about. It might sound irresponsible, what we're doing, but it is not, because we're there for the good game and we're trying to solve the world's problem. Or one of them. So one more thing, you know, Apple style. PyRDP is open source, and we released 3 days ago our FQ binary parsing tool. So this FQ is like the JQ for binary files. So with this, you can, you know, do analysis at scale on captures that you have. So yeah, it's out there. If you want to contribute to it, we would appreciate it. And with that, we are done, folks. You've been generous, you've been amazing. Thank you so much. Yeah, we have time for questions, I think. Do we take questions?
Five minutes?
All right. Yeah, so I don't know how questions work, but yeah. Do people yell, or are they microphones? So there's a microphone in the back, but if you're willing to yell, and I'll repeat the question. The question is, how am I getting around Amazon's abuse policies? I told them I'm doing this type of research. So all the cloud provider, I open a support ticket, which I screenshotted, which I printed, which I tattooed on me, saying I'm gonna do this. And Amazon, I never got anything from them. Zero. But at the same time, if you break prod, you piss your customers. So I understand they're not doing it, right? And I'm not doing hypervisor level, we're not doing hypervisor level attacks or whatever. It's just RDP. So yeah. And it all comes from one IP if you think about it, right? But they're not blocking outbound, and yeah, so no harm, and it's for research. And I am affiliated with a security organization, so maybe if you do this under your own name, you could have problems. But I didn't face any. Good question, by the way. Are you working for Amazon?
This, I was censored right there. I asked, are you working for Amazon?
Okay.
All right. Any other question? Yes.
Can you talk some about the statistics in terms of the time frame of how long the guy gathers the information in the RDP session?
You want to take that?
So, yeah,
so the question is, how long did we did the collection? For how long?
So the data were collected over 3 years, but like the system was not always up, so it's because it was in development, right? So, but it's 3 years of data on and off. Yeah.
Other questions? Yes. So he asked for an overview of the FQ tool. So you know JQ, it's a, like a linterpretifier and a query tool that is using like CSS selectors for JSON stuff. So it's basically the same thing using a very similar language. So for binary files like PEs or PCAPs or stuff that people provided support, it's really nice. So if you've used 010 editor template, they have their own language which allows you to dive into binary files. It's very similar, but in a scripting way. So like T-Shark is for PCAPs basically. So with this, you can say so our when you pass RDP capture in it, it's seen as an array of events. So these are, and they have types. So there is client information, mouse, you know, display and stuff like that. So you could say, I want the keyboard events if they match this characteristics. List them out. And so for this is why we could do stuff. We could have like, we want to find credentials in general, and then we could provide a list of. Restrictions, and so we would get out only that. So if you're doing binary research on any binary stuff at scale, like thousands of files and stuff like that, super interesting. Yes? How big is a file? You wanna take it? Okay, so because you saw the large file, so we went after like size first. But so what's interesting is that if you don't do a lot, they're going to be small. The window is tiled and then compressed. But if, for example, you watch porn, not that I encourage that. I've never done it myself. But it is going to be huge because you're sending a ton of tiles and the windows cannot cache any of it. But if you're using explorer.exe and like stuff that Windows knows really well and can cache, then they are small. At some point, she was going after the large one, and it was, yeah, tell the story.
I thought that like the large one would be the most interesting one or the longer session, and it was only porn. So I was like, 1 week of porn, I was like, I cannot believe I did a PhD to watch porn at
work, which I had to clear to HR, by the way. I was like, she's gonna watch porn, but it's research.
So yeah, but the second week of analysis, it was way better. Like it's not, it really depends what they do on the session, but they're not so large files.
And I also said like, if you're not okay with this, we'll find someone else. Like it's not mandatory. Cleared myself out of a problem. Yes. So the question is, were people able to identify that we were a honeypot? What's your feeling about this?
What?
Like to realize that it's fake?
Oh, so yeah, there's not much of them realizing anything because of course they connect to their own personal emails and things like that. So obviously they do not know. But there was one guy at one point, well, guy or girl, at one point that just run a little reconnaissance and then open the notepad and then write lol and disconnect. So I was like, oh, maybe he knows, but we are not sure about that. on a fini.
Yeah, we're done. Thank you, folks.
Thank you.
It was nice. You've been super generous.